roll-off time. The faster you ride, the harder the steering becomes, especially in high-speed S's. Rolling the throttle off, then steering, then getting back on the gas again in the middle of two turns can actually get you through faster than if you push through and have to roll off at the exit of the two turns. The rolling off and back on again should not take more than 1 second, and the gas is completely off for only a small fraction of that time, if at all. Avoid snapping the throttle on and off until your timing is perfect. Tiredness equals loss of timing. When you become tired, the first thing you lose is your timing. This is another reason it's so important to have your reference points and products well established. Subproducts, the major steps or changes in a turn, are also points of timing. Not all RPs are points of timing. Some only tell you where you are, signaling an upcoming change or point of timing subproduct. If you know where they are and what to do there, you won't have to slow down as much when you become tired. You probably won't be willing to go faster, but that can wait until you're sharp again. Timing in the road you ride. Changes in the road affect timing dramatically. You not only have to work the controls correctly, but you have to fit that into the camber changes and radius changes as well. For instance, if you are coming up to a bank turn where you would have to use the brakes first, you should know that the suspension will compress more in that turn than it will on a similar turn that is flat with no banking. To go in perfectly, you would let off the brakes as you go into the banking, just as the suspension is taking the load from the centrifugal force. This will give you the smoothest entry. You back out of the brakes just as the turn takes over the job of compressing the suspension. If you brake too hard and the cornering speed is down, the bike will rise up when you hit the banking. The suspension will unload. If you get off the brakes too soon and then hit the banking, the suspension will compress. The second of these is the better of the evils, as it offers a better traction situation. Doing it right, of course, is best of all. Off-camber timing. In an off-camber turn, it is better to have the bike as light as possible on its wheels to keep it from moving to the outside of the turn too much. You must time your control operations so you're on the gas the least amount in that part of the turn. Traction deteriorates rapidly in off-camber sections, compared with flat or banked sections. Rolling off the throttle very hard in an off-camber has an effect similar to that of rolling on too hard. It loads one wheel more than the other, in this case the front, and can cause the front end to slide out. The rider might be puzzled. He rolled off the throttle and still threw it away. Rolling off usually helps him get through the turns when he's going too fast. Keeping the weight even on the wheels by cracking open the throttle, not accelerating or slowing, gives the bike its best traction in off-camber turns. In an off-camber, set up your point of timing so the bike is accelerating or slowing the least amount possible. That will prevent transferring too much weight to either wheel. Changing the track with timing. In a section of track where a dip compresses the suspension, it is sometimes possible to time your roll-on for that point. Ground clearance increases when the bike is accelerating because the suspension is extending. This tactic may stop some of the bobbing up and down that occurs in dipped parts of the track. Timing can change the track conditions for better or worse. If you get the point of timing right, it can work. If you don't, it won't. Products and timing. Keep in mind through all this that your goal is still the overall product of the turn. You still want the maximum speed, the drive coming out, or you want to be set up for the next turn. If you make parts of the turn work but lose the drive coming out, you've won the battle but lost the war. All the reference points and points of timing, subproducts, must make the product better or you have done a lot of fancy riding that's slow riding. Sometimes it's better to go directly through a rough section of track wobbling and out of shape than to figure a smoother but slower way around it. Your measure of progress is in whether or not your product is improving. Points of timing are subproducts, and this is where changes are made. Every place where you take any kind of action is a point of timing, especially when you're in a turn. Upshifting on the straightaway, for instance, is a point of timing, though it's less important than where you steer in a turn. Becoming familiar with your point of timing and products allows you to loaf on the rest of the track because you now understand where you have to work hard and where you don't. If you get these facts down on paper or well memorized, you won't be saying things like, "I'm having trouble in the S's." You'll see which point of timing are working and which are fouling up your product. Familiar or even unfamiliar roads don't change this. You're going to do the same things with the bike. Slow it down or speed it up and steer it. What riders generally leave out of this is looking ahead far enough to choose where they will do them. That is where your visual skills come in very handy. Timing and perspective. To put timing in perspective, let's look at Turn 6 at Riverside Raceway in Riverside, California. It's a good example because hundreds of riders are still baffled by it, and it's the most complex turn I know of. Even though Riverside Raceway is now a housing tract, old Turn 6 was quite an example of timing your riding to conquer the road you ride.